Whenever things got rough, I always remember what my father used to say.
Running a business does test a man, my son. There are ups and downs. Glorious highs, and sometimes a low that leaves you feeling defeated.
The character of a man and the character of a business are not very different, are they?
Yes. But when the chips are down, we must stand up, dust ourselves off, and motor on.
Volatility. It's a funny thing. It makes you question yourself and wonder if you've made all the right decisions.
Sure, you can question some of your decisions, but stay steadfast on your goals.
Dad always said, there are no shortcuts and no quick profits.
There are no free lunches, are there? There is only one.
Right way.
At PPFAS, we think like Rahul and his father. That volatility is a fact of running a business. And buying equity shares is like owning a part of that business. We use value investing principles to manage your money. This means we invest in the right businesses at reasonable prices and for a longer term.
PPFAS Mutual Fund. There's only one right way.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme related documents carefully.
Hi guys, welcome to a new venue. So today we'll talk about one of my favorite sectors. I hope you got what a sector is. So talk about pharma sector. Let me just put the context right out there. You know, how big is this industry and what kind of numbers we are dealing with here globally. So don't look at the estimates, but as of 2016, it's slightly over $1 trillion of global market in drugs. And it's growing decently, probably at 4-5, sometimes 2-3% kind of a growth rate. This includes generics as well as branded medicines. So out of this 1 trillion number, a quarter of it is the generics market as of end of 2016. So whenever I have talked to people who are experts in studying pharma sector or pharma space, when they tried to explain it to me, this is the kind of look I always had. You know, I always was so confused that so many terminologies, you know, branded kya hai, generics kya hai, and all these things always haunted me. So I just want to take a poll in this room. How many of you feel the same way when you hear about the pharma space? Okay, quite a few of you. So this presentation is designed for people who don't know much about the sector, but we can go into depth if at all there is interest and if you can cope in this 1 hour's time to add this to your list. So from a 10,000 feet view, this sector looks incredibly attractive right now. You know, everything we look for in stocks, you know, low valuation, 2-3 year lows, or sometimes even 4 years lows, and all these things we can see from a 10,000 feet view. But you really have to dive into companies to understand why those valuations may or may not be justified, or figure out where the opportunities lie and how well coped these companies are to take advantage of these opportunities. So I'll just go through the basics for those who are uninitiated or who feel the same way as the guy in the photo earlier. So the overall drug market has two kinds of drugs. One is prescription drugs and the other one is over-the-counter drugs. And prescription drugs, we have branded or patented medicines, or we have generics which are off patent and unbranded sometimes. So we'll take a look at all of these one by one. So first we'll compare the prescription and the OTC drugs. Don't read through it, I'll just summarize things for you. So the prescription drugs, as the name suggests, is a drug prescribed by a doctor, which is a controlled substance. It cannot be given to everyone because it has some certain therapeutic values and also can be harmful to you. So it is controlled and the supply chain is quite controlled. OTC is something which is a formulation made for a very specific purpose and it can be dispensed off the shelf. You can buy it like a Crocin or something very easily without a doctor's recommendation or a prescription. So these are generally milder drugs, whereas prescription drugs are stronger, more targeted towards a specific illness. and generally tend to be more expensive because a lot of research has gone into them, whereas OTC drugs may be less expensive than prescription. And the most important part is the prescription drugs are covered by insurance, whereas OTC is like buying candy in the store, so it's not covered by insurance. I wish though candy was covered anyway. So the prescription market can be further divided into, as we saw, branded, which is patented drugs, and off-patented or generics drugs. So generic drugs as compared to the patented drugs differ in very few ways. So they may look similar in size and taste and flavor and everything and do the same thing, but they are basically reverse engineered from the off-patented drug. So if a company has a branded drug in its pipeline and they're selling it, and somebody makes a generic copy of that drug, they have to basically take the drug, reverse engineer the manufacturing process, the ingredients, everything, in order to get the same kind of drug out in the market. And mind well that this company who has copied the drug or reverse engineered it, the right word to be used there, they haven't done the clinical studies which the initial patented company has done. So one company who has spent millions or probably billions of dollars in launching a branded drug outside, the other company who's making a ripoff of that has only done the process engineering part rather than the entire testing of how well the drug works in different scenarios. So it's generally believed that generic drugs sometimes are not as effective as the original formulation. And that's a debate. I mean, a lot of drugs are equal and similar, but in pricing terms, they can differ by 80-90%, sometimes even 95% cheaper than the branded drug or the patented drug. So this chart is probably the most important chart for the pharma sector. So on the y-axis, we have a reduction in price in percentage, whereas on the x-axis, we have months since loss of exclusivity. What it means is you no longer have the exclusive rights to sell this drug under the brand name. So what happens in the first year, when the exclusivity is lost, the drug's price can fall to as low as 66%. And as years progress, as more and more competitors keep coming into the market, as they start reverse engineering the drug and start making a generic version of that, the price reduction can keep going down. So this is a situation where competitors are limited to 3 to 4. When you have 8-9 competitors in the market, it can go as low as 90% sometimes. Now you'll wonder why a company can sell a drug at 90% lower value as the original drug. It's just that the margins built into the patented drug cover the historical costs of R&D, the marketing and clinical trials and all those studies baked in, and they have to earn the cash flows till the exclusivity exists for the patented drug. In a generic drug, they have spent a limited amount of time and copied it, and they have brought the drug to the market. So all they have to spend money on is marketing. So their gross margins tend to be higher if they get the raw materials from some low-cost country or low-cost plant. So the overall product's cost may be same for both companies, but historical cost built in, one company has to charge higher to get a good IRR for launching that drug. So far, so good? So please stop me if you feel it is too complicated or I'm using too much jargon, so I can explain and simplify it for you. So generics drug are divided into several categories. Some of them are really good divisions or good separators, but some of them are very nuanced and may not be separated enough. So the first one is unbranded generics. So when a product is patent, off patent, and somebody makes a generic, they can sell it under the chemical name, or they can brand it into some other name. So for example, if Crocin used to be a patented drug and it's no longer in patent now, they cannot obviously use the Crocin trademark to sell that drug in the market. But the formula which makes Crocin can always be sold as a formula. You can always call it XYZ, which is the formula of that, and sell it across the counter to anybody who wants to buy Crocin. And it will be cheaper than the branded medicine, because the branded ones will not want to reduce the price as low as generic version. The branded generics also is covered in that example, where you know you have a brand, it's off patent now, but the brand is still known in the market. Everybody is prescribing the brand rather than prescribing a generic version. So many times what happens is doctor will prescribe you a medicine, and if you realize the price is too high, you might over the counter want to swap it with a generic version of it, which is not allowed in India, but still many people do it, and pharmacists also indulge in that. So a lot of times, branded generics don't get the same respect that they deserved in terms of the research that that's put in inside. The one problem which many doctors, if you talk to them about branded generics versus generic generics, which are unbranded generics, is that they don't work the same way sometimes. The intensity of the drug or the time required for the drug to act in a person's body, all these very fine nuances of that drug sometimes get lost when people are trying to copy the formula. It's, for example, if I'm trying to cook my mother's recipe for dal, I mean, she has been doing it for such a long time. Maybe, I don't know, some magic flavor she puts without anybody's attention. And it tastes patently different from mine. But both are dal. But when my father will have it, he will immediately recognize that my dal is different from my mother's dal. So, bad example, but yeah, it covers the whole idea of my mom's dal versus unbranded Raunak's dal. So, just an example. So, Cefspan is the brand name of the chemical called Cefixime. I don't know, I cannot pronounce it, just starting with a C. So, the whole idea is when you are in the branded space, you can sell this brand called Cefspan under its brand name, and everybody will know and prescribe by Cefspan. Nobody will use the trade name, which is Cefixime. But if a generic company comes in, it can create its own brand name or it can sell under the trade name, and it is as interchangeable over the counter. So if you say Cefspan and say you don't want to pay so much for that drug which is branded, you can actually ask for a generic and they will give you this exact same formula, but it won't be called that. It's just the same medicine. But why have brands then? After something is off patent, why do you want to retain the brands? Obviously, one thing is to keep charging higher money for that. But most of the time, patients prefer brands. So I'll give you one drug's name. It's called hydrocodone. I cannot pronounce this. I won't try it. So hydrocodone. So if this drug is sold under the trade name, you wouldn't recognize what drug it is. But if you have seen the show Dr. House, you have practically seen an 8-season commercial for a drug called Vicodin, which is made by Abbott. So Vicodin is basically a drug which is a narcotic pain reliever. It's an opioid. So every pill that he popped was a ad for Vicodin and a sale generated somewhere. So I'm pretty sure every episode Abbott employees would do ka-ching and be happy about the show. There's another category in branded generics called authorized generics, where these are basically private labels. So if a pharmacy chain who has contracted someone to copy a generic, and there are big pharmacy chains who are capable of doing that, or there are specialized entities who are intermediaries, we'll discuss in the further slides, who have contracted somebody to make a generic version of some branded drug, they would have a private label generic available in the market, and it will only be sold in that specific retail or pharmacy network. The most important category of generics nowadays is specialty generics, where almost all companies who are listed in India or even abroad, the MNC pharma companies, are vying for a very big market share of specialty generics. And we'll see in further slides in detail what it actually means. But before telling you about specialty generics, this is one term you need to understand. It's called a new therapeutic entity. So it's a therapeutic entity and not a drug. So the difference here is, it's the same drug, but there are different ways that it can be therapeutically used. And that's what adds to the complexity of that particular molecule or a formula. So there can be various formats. I'm seeing some people are lost, so if you want me to repeat something or explain something better, please ask questions. All right, so far? Slightly heavy. Slightly heavy? Which part? I can explain to you again. No, I have not explained it yet. No, I'm coming to that. So if you're okay with the previous branded and unbranded differentiation, I can move on to this particular thing. So imagine that there is a particular drug which is already in the market, the chemical is already in the market, but a company who has already made the original product will not stop researching, or other companies who have figured out a way to copy it will not stop researching as to other aspects of that drug or the molecule which can be used for other illnesses, or in certain cases if it is delivered by a different means. So if you are taking a tablet before and now you realize that if you inject it through IV, it is far more effective, then that will be a new kind of formulation. So the same molecule can be delivered in a different way or in a different format, and it will react in a different way or will be more effective or less effective based on what outcome you want. And for all these things, so the number that we see on these pharma companies' income statement, the R&D expense, mostly goes into figuring out the reverse engineering as well as other therapeutic aspects of the same molecule. So there may be approval given by the US FDA for a oral drug, like a tablet, but nobody has sought an approval for an injectable drug of the same molecule. So if you are the first person in the market to come up with an injectable drug and you convince enough doctors in the network to prescribe that drug and convince them of the effectiveness of that drug over the pill, and no, there are benefits for each of them and pros and cons. So if you convince enough people, you actually capture the substantial market share of an injectable product of the same molecule. So it may be a generic, you may not have to even copy the drug, it may be off-patented, but you are the only person who is selling the injectable drug and you can basically charge whatever you want in that time frame until some new competitor figures out, and the graph that we saw earlier where the prices keep dropping, it drops even further even for you. But what is the incremental cost for you as a generic manufacturer to make that drug? You haven't incurred the previous costs of R&D and anything. You haven't set up the plants to, you know, engineer the entire process. All you have done is you have copied the formula and put it in a different way of delivering it. So each and every new delivery mechanism has its own complexity, right from making sure that it is not harmful for the body who is consuming it. It works across the cross the spectrum of the illness. So it should work well on women as well as men, or of different ethnicities, of different genotypes, as what they call. Again, it is also sometimes discovered that, like in any scientific discovery, you keep tinkering enough and you find other applications of the same drug. So famously, Viagra was a drug which was not just for erectile dysfunction, but also for improving the heart rate of blood which is flown to the heart. So they discovered the other aspect of Viagra by chance. So in this case as well, you might have a chance discovery of an unmet medical need which this particular molecule can solve. So all these complexities have to be tested over years, and you have to spend a lot of money, a lot of scientists are involved. They have to do clinical trials and figure out how effective these combinations can work across different examples. And lastly, you have unique manufacturing processes. So if you have only made pills and tablets all your life as a manufacturer, and you have not learned the way to make an injectable drug, which is a liquid form of a drug, to make the formula last long enough, it should also have a supply chain in place. So all these systems have to be also designed again or anew for this particular drug. So all these innovative techniques, they comprise of the complex generics space right now, and which is what most of the Indian companies, so when you look at the value chain of drugs, it's no law. So they started off making the base raw materials for the branded products. When they realized that that business no longer was viable, as more and more players started making it, they realized they should go one more step above in the value chain and directly start making the drugs itself. So a differentiation in definitions is the raw material is called API, which is active pharmaceutical ingredient, which is a very commonly used term when you discuss about pharma companies. Or bulk drugs, that's what the other word is. So these are the raw materials which make the actual drug, which is the formula of that medicine. And formulation is basically the format in which you deliver it. A formulation is a tablet, a formulation is a capsule, a formulation is an injectable, a formulation is a skin patch, a formulation is an inhalant. So whichever way you formulate a drug, it can be delivered in a specific way. So all these things comprise of the complex generic space. Yes, Gaurav.
So basically, assuming the drug is already in the generic system,
yeah.
Right? Not no longer patented and
yes.
Stuff like that. But assuming they've come out with a new delivery system, the delivery system can be patented.
There are process patents and there are product patents. So
right.
Even if you have a process patent, you can still sell it under that process patent at a higher rate. So
right.
You will get an exclusivity till somebody else figures it out.
Okay.
So many a times, the company which manufactures the original drug, they keep having a back-end R&D work going on to find various ways to keep extending their exclusivity.
Right.
They call it evergreening. So there is product evergreening, where you tinker with the formula and add some very minute feature and say that, oh, this is something new. Can this drug still have an exclusivity? And sometimes they get, sometimes they don't. But in process patents, you can actually have exclusivity of the process itself for a certain amount of time. But by the time people figure it out and approval delays, we see the timelines as well, there are delays in approval, all these things. And since competition is so intense, somebody else immediately figures it out, the formula is out anyway in the market.
Fair enough.
If you have a process patent, it's a defined period of time, right?
Yeah. It's generally a shorter period of time.
So
than
if somebody else figures it out, you already have that patent for that period of time.
Yeah, but if you don't get the approval, so you may have a patent, but from patent to actual sale, there is a period of time and you have to wait for the regulator's approval to allow you to sell that drug in the market. So your exclusivity might die down in that period. So just for instance, you get 5-year exclusivity to sell that particular process.
But now say you have a pill which has become a generic,
right?
And now you find an injectable version of it.
Right.
So for that injectable version, you'll get another 5-year exclusivity.
Yes.
So for those 5 years, competition can't come and sell that, right?
Yeah, but they have to also get the approval to sell that drug. If, for example, US FDA has not approved the new therapeutic entity, the new formula of delivering it, and they are awaiting the approval from there, your exclusivity is meaningless till that period of time.
So you're saying before the approval comes in, so before it gets patented, if somebody else also comes out with that, then you're not going to get the patent.
Then there's no patent for everyone. It's all out in the open. Then the race is for approval date rather than...
So it's not whoever applies first for the patent would get the patent, but...
Generally that works. Whoever applies first gets the process patent first.
Yeah.
But the patenting is easy. The part is to get the approval to sell in the market. So the FDA, so for example, if you are the US FDA and somebody applies to you that this is the same drug but in a different format, you will want to actually go and visit their supply chain and see if the plant is compliant with the good manufacturing practices that they expect. And that delay might be 1 or 2 years, whatever it is. So the delay can actually make you lose that kind of market. And it is baked into the pricing. So people understand that there is a delay and the price products accordingly. And just because you cannot sell it in the US market, there are other markets who are far less stringent in terms of their approvals. But they can sell anywhere else.
So typically you wouldn't expect process patents from generics?
They do apply. I mean, it's quite common in the industry to apply for them. But they may lose meaningless. They lose meaning because other people also apply for them at the same time. And everybody is at the top of their game. I mean, it's not something that is not known. Because if somebody is making it, somebody discusses in the conference, it gets out anyway and people start copying.
I mean, typically I'd assume that you do the process patent before your brand goes off patent, right?
Yeah.
So all of that would have already been kind of done and
yes,
it's out.
Yes, so they time it accordingly.
Yeah.
So the timing has been the most critical part in the pharma space. So a lot of times we see these spectacular growth numbers in generic companies is because they suddenly achieve exclusivity of 180 days for a drug which they thought they will never get exclusivity for. And you see 40% sales growth in one quarter suddenly for a product, which is because of that. I think it's 20 years, I guess. If I'm not mistaken.
Is process patent only for bulk drug or is it for formulation also?
Mostly for formulation, if I'm not mistaken. The bulk drug is a formula which is already available.
Okay.
That is the original product patent that you have. The formulation and the bulk drug, the combination of that.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the active pharmaceutical ingredient which goes inside that. It is what helps you heal or whatever.
I wanted to understand the liability part of it. Is it if a particular formulation or delivery system doesn't work, or is all the liability on a body like US FDA or is it also on the companies? Like how does that work?
So when you get the approval, you have to prove that the drug has gone through the same checks and balances that it is supposed to go. And the liability falls on the company. If they have to do a recall, they have to do it.
But they've passed through certain tests from the bodies, right?
Yeah.
So shouldn't the body be ultimately...
No, the problem is in this particular instance where the company is a generic maker, it may not have done an extensive study across a lot of types of different conditions. So for example, a drug might work perfectly in a person who has only that illness. But if there's a combination of illnesses, it may not work in the same way. And it might be even harmful. Then you have to make sure that there is a case and there is a warning mentioned that if you have so and so condition, please don't take this drug.
So, I mean, what I understand is most Indian companies don't have huge R&D centers, right? Like
yes.
It's so how do they, if they reverse engineer a particular drug and if it has a side effect, unwanted side effect on somebody, how do they even check that it won't happen or they can Like,
so how the does network, the network of doctors and all who are prescribing the drug, they immediately get a feedback, and if that feedback is very common, there's a recall initiated. So basically, you lose your ability to sell that drug in the market for the time period till you rectify that problem. And if somebody else has figured it out, your competitor has figured it out.
That'd be a very low sample size, right? Like from your network of doctors.
Yeah, but people have to be aware. So it's not like people, when the drug is out in the market, people will completely close their eyes. Okay, I'll just keep counting my cash now. So they have to figure out that the drug is being prescribed properly, it has been given in the conditions that it is supposed to be given in. And then the feedback is statistically seen that wherever the errors are and what is the cause of the errors. And then you modify prescriptions. So there is a whole other complex part of this. So generally we tend to talk about US more because US is the most discussed in the media. There are other countries where the laws are totally different, where they are okay with some level of errors and they still let the drug go because the pricing and everything is, so it meets its specific requirement. All side effects are announced already to the patients and they have to bear with them. So moving on with complex generics. So we saw complex generics as a category of new therapeutic entity, but there is a complex active ingredient or a complex API, so to speak, where what we have so far seen is a non-biological or a chemical product, but there is something called as a biological or a biosimilar product, where it is synthesized in a living organism like a bacteria or a fungus or any other culture that we can grow in a laboratory. And they will basically grow that active pharmaceutical ingredient within these cultures. So you will have huge vats full of bacteria, billions of bacteria, and they will synthesize that drug under certain conditions. And these are biologicals, and this is one of the hottest area right now, where everybody, almost all big pharma companies have spent money in creating the copies of the existing biological products which are out there. But these are freakishly difficult to make because, like I said, it requires a certain condition for that organic entity to produce that drug. And most of these processes are not exactly the same. So for example, if somebody is making that drug in the US in the plant, where temperature difference and humidity and everything is different, whereas in India, you'll have to exactly replicate the same configuration in your laboratory to get the exact same chemical. And if you miss, if you get a batch wrong of bacteria a little bit, the drug becomes completely different. So this is notoriously difficult to synthesize, and yet a lot of companies have spent millions of dollars to come up with biological products who have probably no way of getting approvals in the US market so far. But rest of the world, there are limitations with which they can sell these drugs, and in Europe they are being accepted now. Even in Japan, they are accepting some of the biologicals right now. Is this confusing or it is? Any specific question I can address so that? So, say penicillin as a chemical is made chemically. You know, you mix two chemicals, a formula is created, and you get that penicillin. But now you have figured out a way to mass produce it by making a bacteria produce it. Some scientific innovation has been done where one bacteria cell can keep producing penicillin. Imagine billions of them keep producing the penicillin. So you don't have to use any chemicals to actually create that API, but this particular bacteria which is available in nature, you can grow it in a laboratory. And
so is that just done for scalability?
It is one part is that. So the other things associated with that. So when it's organic, so for some people in their bodies, the chemical drug made out of chemicals doesn't suit some people. But the organic drug made by bacteria of the same formula can suit them. So there are a lot of therapeutic requirements which get addressed because of a organic manufacturing process. Yeah. Rajiv can add something to that. One sec. It's always a good idea to let Rajiv take the tough questions.
Yeah, so why do we have biologics at all? Why not just use chemicals? So a lot of you may have, in school textbooks, we would have come across the vaccines typically use the same entity, whether it's a bacteria or a virus. The human body creates antibodies for that, which is used to build immunity. Or sometimes, let's say, even in food, food is created by fermentation. Now that is not created in a laboratory. Bacteria work on that food and create some process. Insulin. Insulin is naturally produced in the body. So sometimes it may be helpful to make biological entities produce that insulin rather than create it in the laboratory. So it's well known why do we use biological processes to create some of these medicines. There's a long history. The context to why is it difficult to get approvals for biological entities. Let us say there are two seeds produced by the same company. You plant those two seeds in a soil, you give the same amount of fertilizer, same soil, same amount of water, same amount of sunlight. Will those two seeds grow exactly the same? No, one may have three branches, another may have four branches. So it's very difficult to say that both are equivalent. So FDA and various other people have been struggling as to how, what are the parameters to put in to say that these two things are equivalent. Where it's a chemical molecule, equivalence is easier to prove. Where it's a biological reaction or a biological produce, proving equivalence is that much more tougher. That's the context.
So we saw in the previous slides about complex formulations and complex delivery systems which can be engineered to deliver the same dose. So we might pop a crocin pill or snort the powder of crocin. It will have different effects in the body. There's also complex drug and device combinations. So if you know how inhalers work for asthmatic patients, you can always take a pill for asthma, but the inhaler will work immediately on your lungs. So there are several drugs which can be formulated into a device combination, which can be delivered in a much better way and more effective way. So all these things require a lot of R&D to come up with these solutions. And mostly all companies are on top of the game. I mean, they will, if they know that this drug has potential, they will definitely try and squeeze in some of the copies or anything. And the company which has actually patented the drug, they will have engineers doing the same thing in their laboratories. So they will have a far more effective process of engineering that product than a company which is a generic company copying that drug from the original drug. But yet still, despite that, the market is so huge and there's a demand for cheaper drugs all the time. So the device combinations, all these complex drugs, they are a burgeoning market now. So let's take a quick look at the scale of the global generics market. So the data is only till 2013, but a trend is obvious that unbranded generics are becoming a larger and larger part of the overall medicine market or generics market. So penetration, this is an average penetration across, I think, US, and it's about 80% penetration of generics. So the remaining, I think it's 6% over here. So 6% of branded generics can actually be a higher value part of the market, but the 80% will be a lower value in dollar terms. But it's still huge in terms of volume. So if you are a value player, you will not want to play in the unbranded generics market. You always want to be in the branded generics market because you can extract extra value for that by adding whatever complexity you have exclusivity to in that period of time. But if you are an unbranded guy, you better have cheap manufacturing facilities, you better have cheap raw material availability, and you better have easy access to the market because you cannot spend on any of these things. Your margins will always be lower than that, and you're basically designing your business model on a low gross margin kind of a game. And there are several companies in India who do both. Some people stay in the branded generic space, they create their own brands, and they make sure that they want to extract the high gross margin. Whereas there are players who say that, okay, we are only in the volume game and we'll be the lowest cost drug producer in this particular category. So this is an interesting chart about which type of generic drugs and the penetration of different methodologies of delivering the drug. So for example, if you're looking at oral solids, so all numbers which are above 60% are basically markets which have already been penetrated by many competitors. So any new formulation that comes into this market will not get a very high value. So for example, if something was 100 rupees when it was in patent, it went off patent and became 20 rupees. After 20 rupees and all competitors coming in, it might also be as low as 5 to 10 rupees. But the markets where you see lower penetration, like injectables or patches for skins or ophthalmics or even inhalants, these are the complex generic markets where a lot of penetration has not happened by players. So whoever has exclusivity for some of the delivery mechanisms which I mentioned here, they will still be able to generate the extra return on equity that they can from whatever investments they have made in the R&D in the period of time. So far, so good. So like we said, what is the next opportunity? So why people are so gung-ho about biosimilars and injectables? So this is an estimate from one of the brokerage reports. They estimate that in the next 2 to 3 years, the biosimilar market is $18 billion. The injectable market is $11 billion. So these numbers have to be put in the context. So when they give the opportunity, this opportunity is based on the current value of the patented drug. So if a patented drug is in the market, in the biological category, that market has $18 billion worth of market right now. So when you are going to enter as a generic product, you are basically going to get a pie, a very small part of the pie of that $18 billion. Assuming the price falls by 80%, you are still going to be one of the biggest players in that new kind of a molecule if you have the exclusivity at the earlier stage of the market development. So for example, if you are an injectables player and you come up with exclusivity for injectables, imagine that $11 billion market, you can get a huge chunk of that until somebody else competes with you. So this is just a generic list of drugs that are being made by specific companies and their market value as of 2014. So these are some of the biologics and other drugs which are being made. And these companies' names might be, you may not have heard of them. So AbbVie or Hoffman or Amgen or Otsuka. So these companies may be making very unique products in biologics which are in patent right now. But if you look at some of these companies, so for example, AbbVie is a generic drug maker of a innovative drug maker called Abbott. So it's a subsidiary of Abbott which makes generics for Abbott. So they will make generics of Abbott's off-patented drugs and other drugs in the market. So it runs as an independent generic company, whereas it has the pedigree and engineering benefits of Abbott when they make innovative drugs. So each of these companies who make innovative products, which are completely new and patented products, they have their own subsidiaries which sell generics of their own products. So this allows them to keep some of the value within that group, rather than letting go of the market share to low-cost players from India or China or wherever. So if you see these names, you should definitely know that these companies belong to these innovative companies and they are not some third-party generic makers. So they will have all the advantages. They will not have to reverse engineer any of the innovative products. They will get the formula from the parent company and they will make exact copy of the same drug with the same efficacy and all the standards met. And they will have the brand name as well, which they can charge for. So if you look for any of the drugs in the Indian market as well, so if you buy a Pfizer drug or you buy a GSK Pharma's drug, those drugs will be probably twice the value of, the same antibiotic will be twice the value of a generic trade name of the antibiotic. And there's a reason for that, because they have spent in the marketing effort and the R&D to make sure the product works in specific conditions. And you have to basically go on a limb if you're taking the other unbranded generic product. And not necessarily they're bad, but the effect is not known. So if the company who is selling the drug has not tested it well, then it may have an adverse reaction on you. So this is the most interesting part, because nobody can predict it, so I can say whatever I want. So, so the regulatory framework is simple. Each and every export market has its own regulator which administers the drug. The most well-known is the US FDA. The European agencies are EGMA or EMA or whatever. UK has MHRA. So all these alphabets you can rearrange and make one of the drug agencies in all these countries. The whole idea is to make sure you're applying for an NDA, which is a new drug application, or an ANDA, which is an abbreviated new drug application. So to come back to English, One is the branded and patented product, which is the NDA. And the ANDA means a generic version of the branded product. So all these certifications, which are, you know, in the conference calls, people just keep using these names, Para 1, Para 2, Para 3, Para 4. I mean, they are just signifying of one of the process in which this particular thing is. So for instance, if you're applying for a Para 2 for a generic drug, filing an ANDA, it just means that the patent has expired and now you're applying for a generic product. For example, if you are doing Para 3, which is somehow very lucrative, where the patent will expire on a particular date and you are applying before the patent expires for selling the generic product. So imagine if you get lucky, if five companies apply and you are the one whose application probably beat the other company by 2 seconds by hitting the desk. So you might get a chance to exclusively sell that drug for 180 days in that market. And in that, the price will not fall as low as, I mean, it's in your interest to not reduce the price as low as 80%. You will probably keep the price half and you will still make loads of money without having the legacy investments and costs that the original patented product company made. Para 4 is the most interesting because it is extremely litigious and it can create a lot of lawsuits and a lot of fun newspaper articles to read. So basically the company applying for this thing is saying that the patent is invalid and I am going to sell this drug anyway. And stop me if you can. But the approval has to be sought. So FDA has to review all these processes. The due process has to be followed. And if you again win, you get exclusivity to sell that drug. And the branded drug cannot be sold in the market for that time. So it's fun. Yeah, even for the company who gets the exclusivity. I mean, you will be surprised the number of, so you read the conference calls of pharma companies in India, you'll be surprised the number of drugs, number of sales and cash flows have been made by doing this. Para 4 filings. And sometimes they are worth contesting because people are not idiots. Like, I mean, they understand that some patents are patently fraud. So you can contest that and win. So just interesting thing is if you want to study timelines, I mean, if you want to really bet on a product, what do you have to look at? So when you are filing an NDA, which is a new drug or a branded thing, the whole process from R&D, clinical trials, regulatory approval, time delay till the patent is given to you, time to market where you arrange distributors and everything, it takes about 12 years in average. Sometimes it takes more. And imagine the number of millions of dollars spent, and you have to basically do the study of the market as to how big the market can be. For a generic drug, it used to take 4 years, 2 years to make it and 2 years to get the approval. Now timelines have gone all out of whack. Some companies have been given approvals in as fast as 9 months and have delayed for as long as 4 years. And there's a reason for that. So if you have to understand how the regulator thinks, the US FDA, which is the biggest market, we'll talk about the FDA now. Their aim is to not just regulate the quality of and availability of drugs, but also to make sure that drugs are always available at a cheap price. So pricing is a very important part of their motto. And if they can find somebody who's willing to come and enter into a market where there are only few players and they're cornering the market and keeping the prices high, they will basically fast track the approvals of other competitors who are trying to get,
So my thing was that when somebody is making a generic drug, does it mean that they don't have to do clinical trials just because they are cheap? Because the approval procedure, I'm guessing, should be the same because it's ultimately going to go into the same market and it's the same consumers who are going to have it. So does it mean that clinical trials are not to be done? Okay, patent, we understand that the patent process may not be done because he's producing molecules by the dozens.
Right.
So therefore, he doesn't need to do that. But what about trials? I mean, it's going to be on human life. It's not on animals. So therefore, is that also sort of bypassed? Because then that means that everyone, even the established companies, will start moving on to generics in a very big way, which is already true by the graph that you showed with the amount of penetration, and which means all the investment that they have done in the developing of molecules which are patented, they will make huge losses and pharma will be under the ground for a very long time.
Right.
All, and because we are also a hugely pharma exporting kind of a country, aren't we? So I was just thinking, so is it really true that, you know, it's a big difference, 3 times more time, 4 years and 12 years, and no clinical trials, nothing, just go ahead, put it in the market. What about the risk? Isn't there a risk? Don't think about it.
There is definitely a risk. And all you have to do as a generic manufacturer is to prove that this is bioequivalent or efficacy is similar to the current drug which is in the market. So you have to do statistical analysis and submit that, but which is not as rigorous as the original clinical trial. So if the clinical trial has said that it works in A, B, C, D conditions, and you are able to prove that in a small sample space, then you are effectively allowed to sell that drug because you meet the equivalence or efficacy standards of the original drug. But there are definitely risks. So these companies play very safe. They have these thick booklets which are inside the pouch of medicine, so in that these are the side effects that can occur, and they've covered themselves from all sides. Yeah. But there is a case where it may be harmful, it may not be harmful, and it only can be tested on a longer study, but which not a lot of people don't do it. So there's no incentive for doing it, right? I mean, you have just copied it. You have proven the equivalence of the drug, and you are able to sell it in the market based on a legitimate approval. But the approval can also be revoked if it is known to cause more damage than what you have claimed. So
a counterintuitive question. If, for example, take Cipla, for example. So Cipla also makes patented drugs. They also are in the market to make generic drugs, and which is sold at a fraction of the price of the branded goods. Does it mean that a Cipla tomorrow starts manufacturing, I'm just taking a case in point, starts manufacturing a lot of generic, and it cannibalizes its own patented drug market because it knows it is gaining so much more in terms of volume? So can that be expected, say, maybe in the next 10 years for a company like Cipla and similar?
Wouldn't do that, right, to yourself. If you know that there is no other competitor going to do it to you, why would you cannibalize your existing market? I mean, intuitively speaking.
No, there will be somebody else who's doing a generic, so you also start doing the generic. That's the idea.
Which is fine. So anyway, they have the low cost base. They can take advantage of that.
Okay.
All the way to the front.
Yes. If you can please pass across. Thank you.
So Karthika, just to clarify, I think there's some misunderstanding. Both don't run in parallel. So a new drug, you first get it patented and say that I am the exclusive guy for this new molecule for 20 years. You spend those 12 years trying to find out whether that molecule is beneficial to patients or not, and whether the side effects are acceptable or not. If that is so, after 12 years you get another 8 years solely to sell. In that period, generics can't come in as long as your patent is valid. Generics can come in only if they can prove that your patent is fraudulent, or for some reason you have tinkered and it's not really original research. So both are actually different products. So just to give you an analogy, a very crude analogy, it's not actually very valid, but let's say Microsoft Windows. If Microsoft creates Windows, no one can copy Windows and install it on PCs just like that. But after that Windows version has run for 8 years, then it's free for all. Then that version, any assembled PC guy can copy it. Something equivalent to that. So both don't run parallelly. I think there's some confusion from the question that you're asking. It's not that the innovator files and simultaneously any person files for a generic at the same time. Generic can come in only under two circumstances, effectively. One is the patent period has expired, or they are saying that the patent is invalid. So if you look at Raunak's previous slide, the patent has expired. That is one scenario where a generic can come in. Or para three, a generic can come in and say that my chemical entity is equivalent to the original drug. Just approve it and keep it, but I won't sell till the patent expires. And the final one, the patent is invalid, in which case you get into litigation saying it's actually not an invention, and the patent should not have been given in the first place. Otherwise, it's not that anyone can walk in and start selling copies immediately after research is done.
The interesting thing is there was a point when global patents were not enforced. So this patented drug would be sold in the, say, US market at its patented price or the premium price. But say in Africa, the same copy can be sold as generic. And that's where many companies made money with the same formula.
Yeah, so currently for some HIV, for some cancer drugs, where the pricing of the drug by innovators is so high that let's say 99% of the population can't afford it, and there's a threat of epidemic, etc. There are some escape clauses where in national interest or in on humanitarian grounds, either the courts or governments invalid patents for epidemics and so on. But otherwise, as a general rule, you can't just go out and copy something which belongs to the innovator.
Diabetes is not an example. Diabetes is
no, so yeah, so a drug which has been around for, let's say, 20 years, anyone can copy now. But if a new drug has been discovered 2 years back, then either as a patient you have a choice, go for a cheaper, older drug, or if you want the latest and the greatest, pay up for the price and buy it from the monopoly seller.
So Android versus iPhone, kind of a market here. So I would recommend a documentary on Netflix called Fire in the Blood, which explains, which is an amazing documentary, that explains the generic business in depth from human point of view as to how it affects the cost of drugs and affect different people in different countries. And even in the country where it is patented, even there people are poor. I mean, even they cannot afford the same kind of quality medical care because the price remains so high. And how politics and global politics is being used to keep the prices of drugs high, and which companies are doing what to make sure that drugs are available. So it gives a human side to the entire pharmaceutical business. Mehul, you had a question?
So the FDA rules, do they vary from country to country? So how can the US FDA implement their 5-year lock-in for a country like India where the rules could be different?
So that is where the global political clout of a country can come into play. And you can have trade agreements. So for example, if you can have import duties on something, you can have local trade agreements. So if you don't allow us to use patents in your country, we will not allow you to sell something in our country. And they can negotiate on an international trade basis.
Yeah, WTO, precisely. Exactly. Earlier, it was free for all. Under WTO, these protection of intellectual property came into force.
Nikhil, you had a question?
You were talking about the regulatory thinking and how they plan try to get the price of the drugs down. You were stopped.
You want me to elaborate on that?
Yeah, a little bit.
So the whole aim of the FDA or the regulator is not just to approve the drugs, but also they have to make sure that drugs are accessible to general population. So a lot of times, if your country is going to fund the insurance or medicine cost or healthcare cost for people, or there are private insurers who are going to pay for that, then in that case, it is in their best interest to make sure that the patient gets the best treatment at the lowest cost. So in that case, you require generic alternatives. So if the market is flooded with very expensive medicines and only two manufacturers are making it and deliberately keeping the price high because nobody else has permission to make it, but a third player is available who can sell the drug at a cheaper rate, so they can negotiate with that third player and make sure that the average price also comes down in the market. So the moment all insurers and all pharmacies in that network start only accepting that generic drug, which is at a lower price, then obviously the other players also have to come to that price and match so that they are also allowed to sell. Otherwise, that drug will get the exclusivity. So it happens instantaneously across. It's a complex negotiation framework. I'm going to discuss on one slide, which is so freakishly complex, it's difficult to analyze those businesses, but they are really good businesses. So before that, I'll just finish the flow of the presentation. So this is just a US patent expiry roadmap. So in the US, so for example, 2016, $18.9 billion worth of patents would be out for expiry. And so each year there will be, all these are current market sizes of the patented drugs. The moment the patent will expire, you will see this kind of a graph playing itself out in all these markets. So, I mean, we talked about the US market so much. Let's now figure out what is so good about the US market to begin with. So, the snapshot of the US market is population of 300 million people. Population over the age of 65 is 48 million, 15% of that. This is whopping, okay? This is really interesting. Total healthcare expenditure is more than India's GDP. It's $3 trillion. This is last year's data, which is 17.4% of their own GDP. Government healthcare expenditure under the government's insurance program is equivalent to India's GDP. private healthcare expenditure is also equal to India's GDP. So total pharmaceutical sales is $333 billion. Per capita pharmaceutical sales is $1,000. So effectively, if you spread it out across people, it's $1,000 per person in terms of how much they pay for medicines per year. Generic sales or generic medicine sales is $70 billion, which is 21% of total sales. And this is the interesting part, where every pharma company wants to make money. $244 billion or 70% of total pharma sales come from patented products, which are still actively sold as their branded products. Over-the-counter market is a $19 billion market, which is all the difference between over-the-counter and prescribed patented medicines. So, I mean, no wonder everybody wants to sell in the US market and get exclusivity there, because people are willing to spend money there. So, as of calendar year 2016, US imported $90 billion worth of pharmaceutical drugs, and India is $17 billion. So it's a big contribution. No other country has such a huge exposure to the US imports.
India exports
to the US? Only US, yeah. No, I'm sorry. This is overall India's exports to the US. I think it does $6 billion worth of exports. Yeah, there it is. Sorry. So if you look at top companies in India who are exporting to the US, so they will have different revenue shares, 50% sold to the US, 60% of the sales come from the US market. So we can see it adds up to about $6.7 billion, and the rest of them are just rounding errors. So all the top companies in the Indian pharma space. So this is where I was saying, it's a freakishly complex business model. You have a question? Oh, sorry. So in the US, it's a little unique. So I will just put this chart here. Don't try to decipher it. It's my handwriting. I'll explain to you. So traditionally, there is this drug company who makes the drug. Can be a generic, can be a patented drug maker. There is a insurance company or a insurance provider, which I will call a benefit provider. That's the technical word. Here is the patient who is basically going to undergo the treatment and going to buy or take the healthcare. This is the wholesaler of the drug, and this is the retailer or the pharmaceutical store, which is basically going to dispense that drug to the patient. So normally, we would never see this kind of thing anywhere in our country, at least. We don't know that there is this particular pharmacy benefit management kind of an intermediary available. Mostly in all other countries where the government provides for healthcare to its citizens, they have their own agencies who will do the negotiation for drug prices. And on the basis of that, drugs will be sold across all the approved pharmacies across the country. But in the US, the kind of market that they have a third party pharma benefit management. I mean, imagine like a third party claim processor for an insurance company in India, something like that. But the role is quite interesting. So the whole idea of a pharma benefit management company is, they think that they have the negotiation skills to let the drug bring the drug companies lower in terms of prices. That will basically help all the benefit providers or insurance companies to get to spend lower on drugs year on year. So now, how do this PBM companies make money? So initially, the whole idea was you negotiate a discount and pass on parts of that discount to the entire value chain, and the drug company basically discounts. So $100 drug will be sold at $80, and $20 will be distributed across the entire chain. So the patient will pay $80 only for the drug. The insurance company will basically reimburse $80 only. So $20 saving adds to the system and money saved, right? So as the model evolved and they realized it's perfectly legal to rearrange this agreement and accept rebates in lieu of volumes. So imagine you're making, say, drug ABC, and which is being sold at $100. That is the list price or the MRP of that drug. And you basically negotiate with this drug company saying that, okay, if you sell 100 million units of this ABC drug, I will give you a cashback or a rebate of, say, $20. In the previous instance, it was a discount on the list price. Now the list price remains the list price, and it's a rebate on the volume that you commit for the drug company. So the company, it seems economical, right? I mean, if you can commit to volumes, I'll give you a discount. We have dealt with this every time. Now, this basically PBM, all they have to do is convince all the network pharmacies, all the insurance providers to commit to that rate, that if you guys are willing to prescribe only this drug, then we can get a discount. So there is a technical word called formulary, which is a list of approved drugs, which these PBM companies manage. So basically, all the companies, all Indian companies, foreign companies who sell drugs in the US, they die to get on that list. So that once you're on the list, at least you get volume. Kuch nahi to volume milta hai. And then the volume is there, your capacity utilization is done, your capital costs are covered, all these things you are taken care of. Now, the problem over here is, it sounds good in theory, but no one knows, not even the US Congress or anybody else knows how these arrangements are actually, are they transparent enough? Can you know how much benefit flows to the wholesaler, retailer, how much benefit goes to the care provider, the benefit provider? And that's the whole bone of contention in the US market right now. Because if you look at the numbers here, I forgot to put a graph there. So if you're spending $300 billion, this number has been growing year on year. I mean, there is one reason that more patented drugs are coming out in the market, or the generic drugs are not falling in price and new drugs keep coming up at higher prices. So we saw the complex generics part of it where, so I'll give you an example. It's a very specific example of a drug called Copaxone. So the drug is for multiple sclerosis, and there was a 20 milligram dose of this drug, which you have to administer to a MS patient 3 times in a week. Now the company called Teva, it's the biggest product. It contributes to about 20-30% of their sales. So they came up with this complex generic version of Copaxone, saying that, oh, it's a 40 milligram dose, but take once in a week. So with multiple sclerosis, the body doesn't function the way a normal body functions. So it's easier for the patient to administer drug to himself and not to rely on somebody else to administer it to you. So the 40 milligram drug administered once a week versus 20 milligram drug, which is in the market right now, administered 3 times in the week. So all generic players are geared to making the 20 milligram generic. So if you go to a pharmacy, they will swap it with the existing drug. But now the company convinces the network, saying that the 40 milligram drug is the only effective drug, which is going to provide the most amount of benefit to you. Imagine if from the list of the formulary list or the drug list, they only keep the 40 milligram drug and remove the 20 milligram drug. So all manufacturers of 20 milligram are excluded, and this company gets an exclusivity to sell that particular drug. No idea how these arrangements are. They don't report it in the annual reports. They just mention that they have this network and they are making sure that drugs become cheaper and cheaper every time. But in the macro level, you keep seeing that America is spending more and more on healthcare year on year. Interestingly, right now, I'm discussing PBM is because it is affecting the Indian players as well. They are consolidating in the US. So the more they consolidate, the more the networks become stronger and more opaque the supply chain becomes. So if a new company wants to muscle their way into a market, you can actually effectively bribe a PBM and get your way out of it and hopefully not get caught. Don't have an email trail somewhere. So there is really, if you think of from a 10,000 feet view, there is no incentive for the drug price to be reduced. So imagine if you don't meet the volume requirement, if you miss the volume requirement by 1 million units, you're going to basically charge all the patients at the highest list price possible, which they could have actually gotten a cheaper price if there was an upfront discount on the MRP. And that's what all the insurance companies are complaining. So in India, we don't have such freakishly complex models. We don't have insurance to begin with. But if the countries where insurance is provided, so all countries are figured out. Only US is the outlier in terms of having a third party PBM. All other countries, the European Union, Canada, just a neighbor, has its own state-owned PBM, which negotiates prices with all companies. So it's far more transparent and public scrutiny happens over there. So this has been the major source of revenue for many of the companies, and which is now under threat because they have become so powerful that either you remove the entire concept of PBM, which is very difficult, or you make sure that it works in the benefit on the longer run, hope that they will pass on all the benefits to the insurance providers. This is a little complex, and I've tried to understand this business, but it's really difficult to figure out how the numbers can move. So these are really good companies. So the biggest company in this is Express Script. It's a listed company. They have $100 billion in sales. I mean, it's a ridiculous amount of money these companies make. This is gross sales, the drug products that they sell.
Express is a PBM?
Hmm? PBM, Express Scripts. It's a private company. It's not a government company. It's owned by shareholders, pays dividends, everything. Buys back shares, just like any other company. So they have an incentive to make sure that the agreement is not exposed to the world. And the drug companies have an incentive not to reduce the price. Whereas people who get affected are these people, where we don't know how much benefit is passed on to. So if you're going to track a retail company which sells drugs in the US, you really have to understand where the source of income is coming from. Is it coming from the PBM? Is it coming from direct sales of the drugs or OTC drugs or whatever? So it affects the entire supply chain. If you're tracking a healthcare provider in the US, a listed company, you have to really understand how much of the money is going to go in the future to just pay for drugs other than genuinely provide good quality healthcare. So the $3 trillion number we saw includes your medical devices, testing, your hospital care and everything. So money can be saved from drugs to other facilities which are required for patients. So this doesn't get discussed too often, but China is also an interesting market for pharma. And again, a snapshot of China, population of 1.38 billion, and these numbers are very dramatically different from what we saw earlier. Over 65 population is twice that of the US. Total healthcare expenditure is only $640 billion. Government healthcare spend is $348 billion. It's a seriously large number. Private healthcare expenditure is $291 billion US dollars. Total pharmaceutical sales is $100 billion. So incidentally, China has become the second largest market by beating Japan in terms of drug sales in the world. So $333 billion is the US market. Number two is China, 108, and Japan is just closer, number three. Look at this. We saw $1,000 in the US, but look at this. Per capita pharmaceutical sales is just $78. Amazing penetration of generics in the market has led to the average price of drugs per capita to be $78 per year. Generic sales is exactly opposite. More 60% of the market is generic and 22% of the market is patented sales. So you can see clearly if the penetration of generic drugs and availability and access is given properly and prices are administered properly, you can have a benefit for a larger number of people. And they also have an export of $2 billion. This number has grown now since last year. So I think China totally exports $7 billion of drugs to the world. India is the number one exporter in the world. And the interesting thing about China is that, so if you look at the trajectory of all the Indian generic pharma companies, they started off by making these very low value products, the bulk drugs or the APIs in the early 90s or the 80s. And most of that, when they moved up in the value chain of making more complex drugs and better formulations and growing their presence in the export markets, the capacities got shifted to China. So in some of the categories, they have 90% plus market share, which nobody else in the world makes. And China is the sole provider for that particular product. So if anything happens in China, environmental concerns or whatever, they shut the plant down, the supply can drastically drop and API prices can suddenly shoot up, which is a significant risk for countries like India, because if we are selling drugs in India at a cheaper price, we are using the cheaper API from China. And then the cost of Indian drugs will go up in India. Interestingly, China is now hiring Indian people, acquiring Indian companies, just like Indian pharma companies are acquiring foreign pharma companies. So they are also stepping up in the value chain now and becoming a formulations player rather than just being a bulk drug and a raw material supplier. They also have a thriving local market. So we saw that the numbers that the government spends on healthcare and private companies spend on healthcare. So it's a local market which is also growing, probably just like India. And they, so CRAM is a short form for contract research and manufacturing. So since China is the factory of the world, why not make drugs? And they're the biggest drug manufacturers in the world right now in terms of volume. So I wanted to leave you guys with a general idea of where companies stand. I'll just paraphrase it for you. So the biggest generic company in the world, which is Teva, has $21 billion of sales. They make a gross profit margin of 50% and a PAT margin of only 1.5%, and they spend 10% of their sales on R&D. Again, if you look at these companies, okay, it's Teva, Mylan, Allergan, along with the new acquisition of Actavis, Sandoz, which is inside of Novartis, Perrigo, Sun Pharma, Dr. Reddy's, Lupin, Aurobindo, Cipla. none of them are net cash companies because they are spending on growing and they have a very lean balance sheet sometimes, and they invest, they borrow money and invest whenever they can because they have steady cash flows. But the interesting part is in the bottom here. Most of the Indian companies enjoy the low cost of API which they are getting from China or making it themselves. And you can see the gross margins to be probably sometimes 15-20% higher than the topmost generic players. A lot of details get lost in the averages, but if you are selling drugs from India in the US and making the API in India, you can expect the gross margins to be around 60% plus. But if you are selling the drugs in India and buying bulk drugs or API raw materials from China, you can expect the gross margins to be around 40-50%. So that's a difference that can make in terms of which market you're selling in. And so interestingly, right now there's a debate going on whether in India we should only prescribe generic medicines because it makes it more accessible for people. But you don't have the capacity for bulk drugs in India anymore. Everything is in China. And the moment something happens in China and you commit to a selling price in India, you're going to shed your profit margins immediately. So if you have committed to sell a drug at 100 rupees in India, whereas you were selling it for 150 rupees before, and China suddenly says, okay, the cost of API is now 20% higher, you're going to get a hit on the margin because you cannot raise the prices anymore in the local market. So the debate will continuously happen as long as we build our own indigenous capacity again, which is counterproductive because we have, if you look at Ricardo's principle, only the most efficient player make what they can make efficiently and trade across each other. So it's an interesting market to look at where a lot of money is involved. Clearly you can see billions of dollars being earned. But dynamics keep changing based on small adjustments here and there. So in conclusion, I would say what will help pharma companies. So one thing is having a good balance sheet, which will help you acquire innovative products, which will help you invest in R&D, which will help you create more complex generics, which will extend your exclusivity in the market over a company which does not have the balance sheet strength to do all these things. So you can be the value player instead of the volume player. Having a decent product pipeline always helps because then you know that there is a roadmap in which you can earn those sales whenever the approvals happen. So you keep investing your balance sheet in the product pipeline and it delivers. And that has been the model in the Indian pharma industry. If you can assure a sustainably low cost of the raw material, making it yourself or from a third party source, you are more or less taken care of in terms of maintaining your gross margins. And because we have seen a lot of regulatory issues right now with Indian companies, FDA warning letters and banning import bans from various facilities, if you are able to get a better regulatory feedback, you're making sure your quality always stays up to the mark that they expect every time, I think you can do it. You can actually be a successful pharma company. So that's all. Thanks. If you have any questions, I will have to take it. I mean, the whole aim of the presentation was to maybe introduce pharma sector in a more friendly way to you guys. Where's the mic? Can you pass the mic there? Yeah. So this slide is not made by me. It is made by, so there's a site called trade.gov, which is a US government's site which manages statistics for all imports, exports that come through the US. So they compiled that. For India, I'm sure there is a slide available, but I had to put the effort to figure out where it is. Probably I'll make it by getting data from all sources and figure it out. Yeah.
So thanks for that. That was very, very helpful. For Indian companies, Indian pharma companies, what has changed, right? Because like whatever you mentioned was always the case,
yeah,
right? Whether, you know, branded going off patent, et cetera, et cetera. Mm. And it's been happening continuously.
Mm.
So what has changed in the last year or two where suddenly, you know, all pharma companies have been under pressure? Like has the regulatory framework stepped up? Has the FDA started doing this every year instead of every 5 years? Is that what causing it? Or what is, I mean, it seems like it's a deep and structural problem that has creeped in. So what is that has changed?
Right. So specifically to the FDA thing. So because US is the most lucrative market to sell in, people want to cater and put the best foot forward about the US market. Regulatory aspect is, say, I would say 10-20% of the problem. The bigger problem is the amount of approvals given to competitors. So if you look at the FDA's current annual report, 2016 annual report, this is the record year of giving the highest approvals in the year. So what does that mean in context? So if you are one of the three players in the market who were enjoying a higher price for that drug. You had pricing power, literally. I mean, I'm not saying they're colluding, but it's just that you understand that this should be the average price you want to charge, and you will not step on each other's toes unnecessarily. Suddenly, five more players get approval, and the chart that we saw, that as the number of years increase, the prices go down in percentage, that precipitously decreases the price, because some player was already out there, say a Chinese player gets an approval for making the same drug. Wow, they can basically corner the market by flooding the market with cheap drugs. So what was your mainstay as revenue growth and cash flow growth for you as a company has suddenly been taken away by somebody else. Or the market has evaporated, basically. It used to be a market, now it's no longer a market. So all your market share advantages you enjoyed in the past no longer exist because somebody else has come in. I mean, just classic economics, right? If a cheaper product is available at the same quality, why don't you prescribe that? And the pressure on the PBMs and the pharma insurance companies, basically, they can also do side deals with manufacturers. They can say that, okay, for some of the deals, we will deal with the PBM, but there are some deals we will do only with pharma companies who are willing to sell at a cheaper price. So you get out of the network. So PBM is not the only source anymore. Side deals can also happen. And when the pharma benefit managers become big, they have more negotiating power in reducing your cost of selling drugs to them. So for example, if previously the rebates were at say 10 million units, the PBM says, okay, I want a rebate at 5 million units. So then you have to basically, you know that the volume is there, but you have to commit to the revenue upfront, the revenue share upfront, for half the number of units sold. So that means half of your capacity will not be utilized at the same efficiency as before. So all these things come together, and plus the FDA approvals banning you from the market. So there are several companies which have gone out of the market, and their competitors overnight became very big in those markets. And suddenly you will see spurts of 50% sales increase in a quarter. And when you ask the management, they will say, oh, this company got FDA ban. So we were there in the market, we had surplus capacity, so we could flood the market with our product. And which is a very common case. So once the market share is lost, it takes probably longer. This has not been proven yet, but it should take longer for the company to regain the market share. The only reason you can regain the market share is because you are already the cheapest cost in the market. So that company was selling probably above your cost of selling the drug in the market. They will go out to the market when you arrive back. But those timelines, which used to be say 1.5 to 2 years of FDA ban to open the plant again, now they have been extended to 4 years. In many companies, five years, there is no indication that the FDA is going to approve the plant again or not. So like I said, it's 20% of the problem, but the remaining part of the problem is sheer economics, where approvals keep coming.
But that's counterintuitive, right? Because you're saying on one hand, they are giving more and more approvals. Mm. On the other hand, you're saying, you know, there have been more and more bans on yeah. factories.
So it seems right? counterintuitive, but the standards of manufacturing of drugs. So for example, when you wanted the drugs to be in your market, you kept your eyes half closed and said, ki chalna, aane de. Let the market be accessing all the drugs that are there in the market. Now when you realize there are so many players, you suddenly want good quality things because you keep hearing issues that drugs are not of the same standards. Then you probably have the budget to ramp up the inspections and say that even the minor infraction, which would have been ignored in the past, is now a severe crime that you should not import until that minor thing is cleared. And each minor thing, so you clear the minor thing, submit documents again, the FDA again re-inspects, all those things have a timeline. Till that time, you're not able to sell in that market. However, you can sell in some other market. It's not banned. But as market share, the biggest, most lucrative profit share is gone for you.
So the Indian pharma companies are essentially all generic players, right?
Yeah, most
and
of them.
So they come in after kind of the price drop comes in. And we've seen typically over a period of time that it goes down maybe 60 to 70% in the first year
yeah.
itself, and then it kind of flatlines around 80%,
yeah. Yeah.
right? So what you're saying is that what has changed essentially is the pricing of their products.
Yeah.
Because new players...
Pricing power going away for yeah, some of the traditional cash flow products that they had.
So, but it's essentially in that 60 to 80% range is where the pricing was going to be anyways, right?
Probably
so
lower in some cases. So that's why the...
So that is the most drastic...
That's why now they have to spend more in going into complex generics where other players cannot easily copy them. So you try and go into nicher and nicher areas which require more and more R&D spend and which may not have the proven market share that you can get because your plant is not approved by FDA to sell it. Then you have to source API from another FDA approved site which will basically charge you the Shylocks piece of your stomach or liver, whatever. So they will charge you that, and you have to basically reduce your gross margins for that. So profitability is getting severely hit because of all these things working together. And problem is, there is no resolution. So companies who have the balance sheet can at least stay on, and they have the processes in place to get back on track. There are some companies who have no process or no idea what to do.
So there's really low visibility in this business then, right?
Yes.
Like across the industry, like it's very difficult to bet on one company versus the other, because
agreed,
the visibility is impaired by so many factors, from the PBM to, you know, the FDA to, competition.
Yeah.
Right?
So I hear all the management's commentary in the conference calls, and I sometimes wonder where the confidence comes from. But of course, they have the better view. They have the driver's seat view, and they can see slightly longer than a passenger in the back. But I think that's the only reason why we have to trust some of them and probably have a portfolio and not get stuck in one company and one idea. That helps, I hope. There's a question in the back.
Whether complex generics means a combination of drugs?
It can in some cases. So you can combine two drugs together and create a formulation out of that.
Because as I understand, that is usually not allowed in the US.
Yeah.
Without carrying out research, because
yes,
you know, together they can have a detrimental effect.
Yes. It's called fixed dosage combinations.
Right.
FDC, which in India was recently as a list of drugs which are banned, which
right,
were just being sold under some brand names. So like, yeah, whatever. So whichever brand names they were.
Right.
They're not allowed in their market, but other markets may allow them. So, like I said, regulatory structure is not same everywhere. So as long as you can find those niches to sell whatever you can make, what will you do with the surplus capacity? That's the whole point, right? And it also depends on what your moral compass says. If you want to just make money, you can always sell whatever you can.
Yeah, one more question.
Yeah.
What is the status of nanotechnology in the whole scenario?
Sorry, I've not studied it, but probably I will read up on it. Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. Rishit has a question.
I'm trying to understand, once an Indian pharma company gets a US FDA warning, what is it that is so tough that they can't comply immediately with? Like, I can understand it may take some time, but ultimately they would be able to comply, right? It's only a process issue. They anyway make the drug. So is there something which is inherently sort of not possible to do, and because of that, the companies that have got the warnings ultimately will not be able to comply in the long term?
So in some cases, you have seen companies have gotten approval to sell again. So that means there is a process of remediation. They will follow the steps to get things back on track. In some cases, they're not able to, because they may not have the staffing capacity. They may not have talent available to exercise the standards. So if you tell somebody 10 times to, so in the kitchen, tell your house help to wipe the kitchen counter 10 times, and it does only once, and that test that day, when you check it, it's still dirty, then you will say, okay, this is still not compliant. I'll come back again. So each iteration you come back again and resubmit your findings or remediations, that process takes time. So maybe in those 5 years, FDA has come only 2 times. So it takes time for the process to reapply, ask them to visit again. When they will come, we don't know. I guess this has been a very long conversation. So thanks so much. Let's join for drinks and dinner.
Whenever things got rough, I always remember what my father used to say.
Running a business does test a man, my son. There are ups and downs. Glorious highs, and sometimes a low that leaves you feeling defeated.
The character of a man and the character of a business are not very different, are they?
Yes. But when the chips are down, we must stand up, dust ourselves off, and motor on.
Volatility. It's a funny thing. It makes you question yourself and wonder if you've made all the right decisions.
Sure, you can question some of your decisions, but stay steadfast on your goals.
Dad always said, there are no shortcuts and no quick profits.
There are no free lunches, are there? There is only one
right way.
At PPFAS, we think like Rahul and his father. That volatility is a fact of running a business. And buying equity shares is like owning a part of that business. We use value investing principles to manage your money. This means we invest in the right businesses at reasonable prices and for a longer term.
PPFAS Mutual Fund. There's only one right way.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.